Welcome to the IVM Podcast Network.
IVM Life is an IVM production, and if you enjoy listening to our pop culture discussion, you should check out our brand new show, Bollywood Scene Stealers. Hosted by journalist Indu Mirani, who sits down to chat with Bollywood's most famous character actors like Ranveer Shori, Satish Kaushik, Gulshan Grover, and more. Episodes are out every Monday. Check it out.
Hey, this is May, and I'm bringing you our very special show from IndusVox Media, IVM Likes. And in the studio, we have got Amit, who's our founder and CEO of the company.
Hey, hey.
And we've got Sharshar Charania, who's
Hi.
Our head of production. And this is sort of like her special show, and we just tagged along, really. And I'm May.
Okay.
I did not know this before.
It is.
I feel like it's her show. It's your
jam. It's a Charania show. I mean, like, she's the anchor for this whole thing, right?
Sure. As a pro-consumer.
Pro-consumer of stuff.
Too much pop culture.
And hi, I'm May, and I'm the creative director at IndusVox, and I have my own podcast, Made in India, where I chat to indie musicians. So every week on this show, we basically get a chance to recommend stuff that we really like. And we kick off with a film, a TV show, and a book. And today, I'm going to start things off, guys.
Really?
Let's do
yeah.
it.
That's so rude.
Rude. So my recommendation is actually a film I saw at MAMI, Paul Verhoeven film. Paul Verhoeven did stuff like RoboCop, Total Recall,
Basic Instinct,
yeah. Starship Troopers. So Paul Verhoeven is this... I like his movies, but they're really bizarre. He's a Dutch director,
yes,
He's strange, very strange guy. So he did this movie, which is probably pretty much on par with his strangeness, a film called Elle. And it's a psychological thriller, and it's this French-German movie, and it stars this actress called Isabelle Huppert, who I don't know why is pretty big now at the moment, because I saw like four films of hers at MAMI. Now, the film, Elle, is about this woman called Michelle LeBlanc, and she's this strong, powerful businesswoman, and she runs this video gaming company, and her employees either like absolutely hate her or absolutely infatuated by her. Now, the thing is, the film kicks off, like, this is how intense this movie is. It kicks off with her having a cup of coffee in her kitchen, and she opens her back door to her garden to let the cat out, and this masked intruder comes in and rapes her. Yeah,
yes.
It pretty much starts, the whole film starts like that.
You sound really excited about that.
No.
I feel like your tone is scary right now.
Apologies, guys. I'm always full of surprises, yeah. So the thing is, it's kind of weird because she decides not to report this to the police because of some past experience that you don't know about. And she eventually tells her ex-husband and a group of her friends. She's like sitting and having dinner with them, and she just says it like she's talking about like she picked flowers today. Mm. And all of them are super shocked, but all of them also understand why she's not telling the police, even though they feel like she's certainly... There's this constant mystery around why
right.
she's not telling the cops about this
right.
incident, right? Now, the thing is, you also find out a lot about her life. Like, she has a son that she's not particularly close to, hates the son's girlfriend, resents her mother, who's, like, sleeping with younger dudes, and she's currently sleeping with, like, her best friend's husband. And then, eventually, you find out, and by the way, this is not the big twist, you find this out pretty much in, like, the first, like, 15, 20 minutes of the movie, but her dad is... a murderer, like a mass murderer. There was a big incident in that area that they live in. And her father sort of incorporated her in the murders when she was like 10 years old. And there's this like, so you basically find out that her relationship with
she's
like
had a messed up life essentially.
Yeah, she's had a really messed up life. So she doesn't want to talk to the cops because she does have this really bad past. And it's not really her fault because
right.
it's her dad who did this to her. And so you, like, there are weird things that happen. Like, in the beginning of the movie, you just see a woman, like, throw a plate of food at her. And you don't know why. And you realize it's all
right,
linked
right,
to this.
Right, right,
because
right.
her dad was this, like, killer or whatever. He's in jail at the moment, whatever. But anyway, she starts getting all these, like, messages and on her laptop and her phone. And you don't really know why. And she starts getting suspicious of, like, all the men around
right.
her.
Right. Hmm.
All the time. And so, like I said, it's this, this movie, right? You constantly feel like you don't know what's going on.
Hmm.
Like, you don't know when. It's like super twisty. Twisty
right.
after twistiness. Like, super twisty. Because well, you don't know what's going to happen. So either you're, like, shocked or you're cringing or you're on the edge of your seat. Like,
okay.
throughout the whole movie. And Isabel Hubert is brilliant. And the pace of the movie, like I said, because you constantly don't know what's going on. You don't know what's going to happen next. And you don't know who the guy is.
Right, right.
And you do find out who the guy is at the end. And it's like, oh, my God.
More twistiness.
More twistiness. So much twisty. But yeah, this is definitely a movie. Yes, I know it started off a little bit. I'm like, what are you talking about right now? But the thing is, the movie is made so well. And Isabel Hubert is really, really good.
Is it a thriller, though? Is it like you're waiting for that end?
It sounds kind of like a psychological thriller. It sounds more like kind of like just a trippy kind of film.
It's
right?
not trippy. It's not like psychedelic or something.
Okay.
Psychological in the sense, like, she just doesn't know what's going on.
Yes, right.
This thing happens to her.
Paranoia and her past.
And whatever that's happening in her life. But it's like, it could have happened to anyone. It's just that this happens to this woman in this way because of these. And it's because of her odd circumstances that this whole thing of that suspicion, because she's not actually reporting this crime.
Yeah.
She's not, because of the fact that, you know, whatever she went through in her past and the media attention that she and her family got or whatever. But yeah, it's a thriller because it gets even worse. Like, even she ends up having this crush on the neighbor, and that ends up being really twisty. There's more to twistiness. I've held back the twistiness.
Okay.
You know? And I've already told you, like, only like 20% of the twistiness. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
That still sounds twisty.
If you want more twisty,
I will watch the twisty.
Paul Verhoeven's twisty.
Yeah.
So, now we have a book recommendation from Amit.
Yeah, so I got a pretty interesting book to recommend. It's called The Ryria Revelations by Michael J. Sullivan.
Mm-hmm.
So, this is one of these books which is, it follows a fairly archetypal kind of format in the fantasy series, which is basically this idea of a nimble thief and a muscle-bound kind of thug, right? And the two of them are partners, and they basically go around having adventures, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, like, there's an old tradition in fantasy for this kind of, this kind of duo who then go out and have various adventures. So this book actually was written as for six shorter novels, right? Each novel about 125, 150 pages. But then when he was able to finally sell it to a regular publishing company, they combined two books into one book so that it became a three-book series. What's really, really cool about this is, like, one of the funniest series that I've ever read, right? I mean, like, so I pulled out a couple of lines from it just to kind of give you guys an example.
Mm-hmm.
So Royce turned to Hadrian. It's supposed to make them look tough, but all it really does is make them easy to identify as thieves for the rest of their lives. Painting a red hand on everyone is pretty stupid when you think about it. That tattoo is supposed to be a hand? I thought it was a little red chicken. But now that you mention it, a hand does make more sense. Royce looked back at Will and tilted his head to one side. Does kind of look like a chicken. You know, so it's like, you know, that kind of, it's very bantery.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, it's got a lot of kind of this banter. And it's a really fun show. So a fun book. So the first book basically revolves around the idea that they kidnap a king. They are asked to go to the palace to steal a sword. And when they steal the sword, they get caught. They've been set up. And as part of the setup, part of the setup is to get the king killed and have them framed for the murder of the king.
Right.
And so then the younger prince who is there basically gets kidnapped by these guys to escape. But it was all set up
by
other people who are there. So, I mean, like, you know, it's just like a really fun adventure kind of story.
Nice.
Yeah. So that's my recommendation, Ryria Revelations. And just to kind of mention, there are two other series related to that.
Mm-hmm.
It was a really huge hit series, the Ryria Revelations. So the author started something called the Ryria Chronicles, which is basically a series of standalone novels in the time before, as a prequel kind of
thing. Oh, before they met
the Ryria Revelations starts at a point when they've been partners for 10 years. So the Chronicles are basically those 10 years.
Right.
You know, so the stories of those different stories.
How they started out together,
how they became partners.
Buds. Yeah.
And the different adventures they might have had. And then they have another series called The First Empire, which is based 3,000 years before this in the same world. It's basically the setup to a lot of the mythology that shows up in the Ryria.
They might not even exist.
No, they don't exist. They most definitely don't exist.
2,000 years ago.
Yeah, most definitely not there.
You weren't there, guys.
There's one common character who I'll not mention who it is.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so Amit's book recommendation for today is Ryrie Revelations by Michael J. Sullivan. And last week I got Sharanya with her TV show recommendation.
Hello. So usually when I recommend a TV show on the show, I'm really, it's like one of those, I recommend it so much. Right. I'm like table thumping about how good the show is.
Yeah.
But this time actually I have a show that's kind of controversial because I admit that it has flaws, but I still really enjoy it. It's called Riverdale on CW. What? I know it's been making a lot of news because of how...
Is this the Archie, Betty, yes, Veronica thing?
Yes. And I know the assumption is that it's pretty trash. And I admit that it is a little bit trash. But I really enjoy it, and I enjoy it like unironically. I don't watch it and go, haha, these people. I actually, like, yeah, I'm invested in it.
Wow.
It basically...
What happened to you, man? What happened to you?
Listen to me.
defend my lame choices.
I'm going to defend it. I think you have to watch it to realize it. So it's one of those teen shows that's really campy, but it's also genuinely interesting if you like teenage, you know, like these teenage mystery shows. Sure, some of the dialogue is stupid. Some of the pop culture recommendations are unnecessary. It's just like trying to put these guys into 2017 setting. So you're like... Oh, remember Archie who read it in like in your childhood? He now reads Toni Morrison, or like he listens to this kind of music. So the recommendations sometimes, like the references they make, feels why?
Really?
You know? So just a basic setting is that it's set in Riverdale, which is where, you know, Archie and Betty and Veronica and all of those characters live.
Jughead's there,
of course. But it's changed so much because it's set up as a murder mystery. There's a murder in that town.
Right.
So it's basically the merging of Riverdale and Scooby-Doo?
I think that's too close because they do call themselves the Scooby Gang sometimes.
No.
That's the thing. The show is really self-aware about what they're doing.
Okay.
They're not trying to be like, hey, look at how we're just cool. It's like we know what we're doing
here.
We get it, you know. So there's a murder mystery and there's like somebody in the town is murdered and everybody's a suspect almost. Some students are suspects, some parents are suspects. Mm. And they've taken a lot of liberties with the characters, which is something I feel like is what's getting at the criticism it is getting.
No, but you know what? I think that when you do something like this, you have to kind of reinvent those characters, right?
Exactly. You cannot base it exactly on what existed as then.
Yeah.
It wouldn't make sense. Like, I think the thing is that...
Archie is a character from the 20s and 30s and 40s and 50s.
So the thing is the criticism is come from for like the nostalgia of watching, of like reading those familiar warm comics that are like kind of clean comedy, you know, just fun, you know, that Archie. But the TV show is very, very different, and I think it needed that upgrade because also it's aimed at younger people who may not find Archie as a nostalgia point for them.
Right.
So for them, it is kind of an introduction of this different kind of world. So I think it's okay if you look at it without trying to project what you read in the comics on it.
Okay, so
I gotta say though, they do take some liberties, which for the first couple of episodes I was like, oh, pearl clutching, like what is going on? You know, there's like Archie's having an affair with Miss Grundy,
yeah,
for
see,
example.
That's the, you know what? That feels like headlining to me, right?
See, but that's
you
the thing. Wait. You got. See, the problem with the show is that a lot of the stuff is spoilery because it's a thriller.
Right.
But that Miss Grundy thing just does get solved, and then you realize that that's not what they were intending anyway. I'm not, of course, saying there are some... A lot of the stuff they do is for headlines. You can tell, like, they know that those blogs are going to pick it up. Like, Jughead's no longer asexual on the show, which I feel like is awful because we needed that character to be like that. Although, surprisingly, tons and tons of diversity on the show. Josie and the Pussycats, all black ladies.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
Okay.
Remember Cheryl Blossom, the character?
Yeah.
In this show, she has a twin brother who gets murdered.
Okay.
And the mystery is surrounding trying to find his murderer.
But okay, so I'm going to look at this in the fact that when you think about the Archie comics, right? You think about it's happy and sweet and cheery, and this is a really like dark undertone that it's
taking. Would you watch a TV show that's an original adaptation of the Archie comics?
No, it doesn't have to be an original adaptation.
Yeah.
But it's about like school. You can make
I do
your
think
school
that there's a thin
somehow.
Excuse to make this a Riverdale setting. It could just be anybody.
It could have been
anybody. They just went with the Riverdale characters because you know who they are. Though I got to say, there are about 8 episodes out and the mystery is still on. Mm. Archie is the weakest character in that show, which I understand now if you look at the comics. Archie has nothing, no
Mosby.
Redemption,
Archie
no personality.
Archie is Ted Mosby.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's always
my God, that's true. In this show, he's absolutely the worst character. Yeah. He is boring. His biggest conflict in life is, should I be a football star or, like, you know, pursue my dream of playing music? And his music is so bad. At one point, all his friends are just like, you know what, you do you, and we're just going to go solve this bigger mystery thing that's happening. You just, you know, use your, like,
do what
your life leads you to. Nobody cares. But it is, I still think it's a really fun, interesting show if you don't try to overanalyze where this is coming from. If you like just teenage campy shows, which I do,
right,
I think it's fun.
Oh, I do too. Yeah. I've seen One Tree Hill and Greek. And
exactly.
I used to love those
that
shows.
Is the
I do,
this.
Like, genuinely.
Yeah. If like, you like Dawson's Creek or you like one of those, it's perfect.
I've never been a fan of those shows ever. But I'm intrigued by this idea of, like, reinventing Archie a little bit, right? Because I spent a lot of time reading Archie's as a kid.
Too, yeah.
I feel like it has to set itself in this 2007 setting, because otherwise it would run out of fuel very fast with the characters being who they were in the comics.
That I don't deny it for a second. Weirdly dark undertone, I'm not sure.
Yeah. So
you're not selling it to me, girl. This is your burn notice.
I'm telling you,
this is your burn notice.
No. I'm telling you, a lot of people watch it, and it's intended at kids who don't find Archie comics nostalgia for them. You know, they know of it, but they didn't spend, like, summers reading it and feel that kind of connection to it that we do.
Yeah.
And if you keep that aside, I think it's fine. I think it's
a
good, fun
show. By the way, if you don't
know
about this Burn Notice reference, go back to our previous episodes of IVM Likes.
Yeah, easily titled, Who Likes Burn Notice?
I like Burn Notice.
Okay, so we'll be right back after this break to talk to you about some more stuff that's getting our goat.
Hello, listeners. My name is Munaf Kapadia.
And I am Nabil Merchant. We are the co-hosts of the show, My Neighbor Zuckerberg.
On this show, we invite ordinary people who have extraordinary stories to share.
Tales of creativity, persistence, and struggle. We call them entrepreneurs.
Tune in every Monday to listen to their journeys. We are available on iTunes, Audio Boom, and the IVM Podcast app.
So now, up next, we have our second part to the show, which is about forgiveness.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So it's technically about the unforgivable.
Yeah, it's unforgivable. It's the opposite
of
that.
Unforgivable.
So basically, this, you know, whether it's a director, an author, an actor, a person who's consistently created or been part of good work, but they've done that one thing that was unforgivable. No defense for this awful piece of work.
It's like, I trusted you. What were you thinking?
I know. Yeah. What was Riverdale?
And you was going to come back.
Back at you, girl.
I feel like you got to give it a try. One time. Two episodes and see if you like it.
You know what? This is my unforgivable. This is for me. Hey, it's Sharanya.
But you haven't even tried it.
Awesome.
Unforgivable is after you've seen it and hated it. You have to see it.
Okay, fine. I believe you.
You got to give something a shot. Like, you got to try it.
So, for Amit, what are your unforgivables?
So I got a few, actually. I think
he's getting a lot of grudges. Guys.
Yeah, I do. I do. I can't help it, man. All right, so let's put number one on the list, right? Mm-hmm. I love Star Wars. I love everything about Star Wars. But Attack of the Clones, that movie was a piece of crap.
Oh.
That was just one of the worst, most miserable movies I have ever had the misfortune to spend my time with.
I just hear producer Abasa cringing like, I love Star Wars!
No, he's in agreement.
He's in agreement. I agree with you completely,
Okay, because I generally don't follow the new trilogy suck stuff, right? So I think The Phantom Menace and The Revenge of the Sith, I think both of those movies had quality ideas behind them.
Mm-hmm.
The Phantom Menace was the first time Star Wars, you really got into the politics of Star Wars. You found out about the trade.
I didn't mind Phantom Menace.
I thought it was fine, right? I mean, like, you know, you found out about, like, the trade wars.
Did you see Phantom Menace?
So, you know, but I mean, like, that stuff I got. I'm sorry if I'm spoiling this for you, but I think you're okay.
I'm fine.
So Phantom Menace, I thought that was, like, not as, it wasn't obviously as great as the first trilogy, but still, solid movie, legitimate movie, liked it. This movie sucked. Attack of the Clones was just the most horrible, horrendous kind of thing. The love story was it a love story? Was it like some sort of stalking going on? I don't know what was happening over there. I really was just baffled. Obi-Wan's trip to the clone factory, what the hell was going on with that? The movie just made it was just the most ridiculous thing. So that's like probably the number one thing. Because, again, I love Star Wars. I love everything about the first three movies. I love the fourth movie. I loved the sixth movie. I loved The Force Awakens. I haven't had a chance to see Rogue One yet, but I'm sure I love that because everybody's told me that's awesome too.
Yeah. Just one quick, like, harp back. Yes. Interestingly, Abbas, in a previous episode, had recommended a documentary called
People versus
George Lucas, which was about, like, the fan base of Star Wars getting so deeply involved with, like, this idea of, like, the hate that he got for, like, some of his...
I'm not surprised.
So it was, like, so interestingly enough, like, Abbas, like, recommended a documentary. So if you want to check out those...
I probably will, because those will be my people, I'm sure.
Those will be your people!
So that's one. Another one I have is... So the first time we did this, I recommended the Wheel of Time series of books.
Oh, yeah.
And there is a book in that particular series. I love that series. I think it's an amazing series. It's one of my favorite reads. I've read it twice, and I've heard it once through Audible. Mm-hmm. And I really, really enjoy it. But there's one book, the 10th book of that series, called Crossroads of Twilight, which is just a turd. it is, you know, as much as I love that series, that book is horrendous.
Yeah.
And the third thing I got to do is, Yash Chopra, the director, right? I've generally been a big fan of him. I was looking through his filmography as a director, and he's made really, really good movies across, like, from, like, the 50s onwards, right?
Mm-hmm.
His first movie was Dhulka Fool, which is a pretty good movie. He made Vakht, which was the first.
I've seen Vakht so many times.
I know,
times.
Yeah. That was the first Lost and Found movie, right?
Oh,
so,
so
I mean,
good.
Like, that was so...
It's like a family that gets separated during an earthquake. And then live their lives till, like, they find each other. It's amazing.
Then he made all the Amitabh movies, Diwar, Kabhi Kabhi, Trishul, Kala Patthar, Silsila, all of those. Mashal was such a great movie with Anil Kapoor and Dilip Kumar, talking about, like, you know, how Anil Kapoor went from a gunda to a journalist and that. So he's made so many great movies. But then in 2004, he made this movie called Veer Zara.
It was awful.
This was very close to the time when I was actually involved in Hindi films and stuff like that. So just as, like, you know, just pure kind of as a thing, like, you know, I'm part of the industry.
Yeah.
I have to be supportive.
Right.
I would always sit through everything no matter what. This is the first time I walked out of a movie. So I was just so disappointed. I mean, like, I thought this guy was, like, one of the best filmmakers we've ever had in India. And then he made a movie about a cross-border romance because he felt like this is the time to make a movie about a cross-border
romance. Yeah, he felt like it was relevant and, you know, like, this is a generation that would understand this love story.
Yeah.
You get it, guys.
Yeah.
It just
did not.
I mean, Aditya Chopra made Befikr. Assuming that this is what modern romance is, and that's the problem.
Yeah.
I think the understanding of what the current generation thinks of love is...
Right. Yeah, you got to be a little kind of this, right? You got to think about this stuff in a it has to be kind of intrinsic, right?
Yeah.
You can't approach it from outside. When you do that, then filmmaking just kind of breaks down, I think, right? So
actually, I've got a contribution to this whole Bollywood thing. Like, I'm incredibly uneducated when it comes to the Bollywood scene.
Okay.
But I quite like Homi Arjania, for example. And I'd seen Being Cyrus, and I've seen actually, you know, Finding Fanny and things like that. But, and I don't know why, in my mind, I was just hoping for something different, right? And I went to the cinema and watched Cocktail. And I've lost 3 hours of my life to piss. Like, it was a horrible movie.
Again. Trying to understand modern romance and failing at it.
It was bad, like bad meaning bad.
So it's really complicated, right, to try and get modern romance into the Bollywood convention.
Yeah. I mean, like, you know, I think the thing with Cocktail, for example, is that for me it was like he set the expectation that this is not like my other movies. This is a commercial Saif Ali Khan. You know, Deepika Padukone, that
Can
kind
I
of.
Tell you something?
So I think the expectation was obviously not going to be that this is like his regular work for me.
You know what? I would rather watch like a Zoya Akhtar movie than watch Cocktail.
No, I
and
agree
Zoya
with you.
Zoya does the same kind of movies, man.
No, I'm saying his other movies are really good, but I think with Cocktail he set that kind of expectation that this is not like my other stuff. This is Bollywood. This is me doing commercial cinema.
Bollywood, but you can still. That's why I'm saying Zoya Akhtar does the same kind of movies, and I enjoy them. Like you know what you're expecting when you're going into
but
them.
But Zoya doesn't do other stuff.
But my point is, Homie does.
I agree.
Homie could have something.
He's a nice guy. He could have brought his sensibility into a commercial movie also, which he did not.
That's the thing. And you know what? I met him. He's such a nice guy. And I'm thinking to myself, like, bro, what happened, man? This is way. No defense. No defense. Okay, so Char, what about you?
Okay, so mine is Aaron Sorkin on television. Now, I'm a huge fan of Aaron Sorkin's writing, even though he, as a person, is problematic. Just recently, last week, he was on a panel where he was surprised that there is a diversity problem in Hollywood. He was like, wait, are you saying women and people of color have to work harder? This is genuinely something he was surprised at. Really? In 2017.
Oh my God.
But I still stand by his work because I love Studio 60. Yeah. And I love The West Wing. And I love First Night. And Studio 60 is one of those shows which I defend a lot.
Yeah.
Because it got cancelled in one season and a lot of people disliked it. But I will always stand up for like an argument on Studio 60.
Yeah, I agree. I thought Studio 60 was
But oh my
great.
God. In 2012, he made The Newsroom. Now, I watched it. And I was obviously very interested and invested because it's a kind of writing that I enjoy.
Yeah.
But man, that show was so problematic that I ran out of defenses for it because I had to admit that this is awful. So many plot lines in that show. The rape plot line, the Africa plot line, just awfully handled in a way that it's like he's lost. It felt like he had lost touch with what was happening.
I agree with you in season two.
Yeah.
Season one, it was a great introduction. I really got into it in season one. And season two,
I think the thing that's problematic with Newsroom is it's just the preachiness of it that doesn't. It's like, you know, he's on a, like the character Will McAvoy is on a mission to civilize, but just feels like, hey man, shut up.
Yeah.
Like,
but
it seems
that,
I gotta say though, it's like also contextual.
Right.
What time you're making this show? What is the scenario of television and of journalism at that time? At this time, in 2012 to 13 or 14 when the show was on, shows were on, like the other shows that were on was Game of Thrones, Breaking Bad, Mad Men, Boardwalk Empire, Homeland, peak Homeland at that time. House of Cards.
Yeah.
There were lots and lots of shows being made about current affairs and generally good writing.
Right.
And then to put Newsroom as a prestige show that was just preachy and did not handle a lot of really important plot lines well, I just felt fairly disappointed. And I feel like I can't move past Newsroom.
So yeah. I agree with you to the point that I think that Newsroom is definitely the weakest of his shows.
Hmm. Yeah.
What I do think happens a little bit though, so most of the stuff that you're talking about is season two, right? And I felt like season two became too much of a answering the question of what happened in the criticism of season one.
Yeah, yeah.
Because season one I felt was very unfairly criticized. I really do feel like that.
Right? I got into it season one.
I think that what happened.
I mean, because people who are writing critics are journalists and he's writing about journalists.
And I think that kind of mirroring did not work well. And the thing is, listen, politicians are not like what people are like on the West Wing.
Sure,
These are not real representations. I really did not.
The thing with the idealism of West Wing is still like this is an American dream of you know how our government works.
This is the American dream for how the leftist part of the country thinks.
Let's make no bones about that.
It's a liberal fantasy.
The problem with Newsroom is he's trying to criticize the media as is then without understanding the media at all.
See,
trying to make it not in a vacuum, right? West Wing is kind of in a vacuum.
Yeah.
You know,
That was the problem with the show. When he started doing stuff like Deepwater Horizon stories, and he started doing stories about Gabby Giffords getting shot and stuff like that, right? At that point, it basically comes off as like, hey, I'm showing you how to do your job.
Yeah, this is how you should have covered this instead. You're a television showmaker.
But that's not exactly what it is.
You don't know what happens in the newsroom. Yeah. You don't know what happened while they were trying to cover this. You don't know how people get. And it's all of these. Look,
I
think that the fact is that journalists take that thing as if that he's talking to them personally. But I mean, like, I don't think that people who are watching The West Wing or people who are watching Studio 60 would say that, you know, that, hey, he's telling me how to do my job.
No, sure. That's what I'm saying. Because it's more in a vacuum. It's one of those shows where you know it's fictional and it's understandable that the world around it is a different world.
Right.
This is a show that he was
trying to kind of place in the current situation. But you know, so I mean, like, I heard why he did that and it made sense to me at the time. But you're right, it didn't work. But what the reason?
I mean, for me, I feel like I like a lot of his stuff, and this is a show I just can't seem to defend.
I get that because I feel like that for me also. This is the weakest of his shows, right? But when he was talking about why he decided to place it in the real world, and he's like, this way I don't have to make up the news stories,
right? I get that.
You know, and I mean, like, if I have to make up the news stories, then we got to spend half the episode talking about the news story itself.
As opposed to this way,
we can talk about the process. That was his thinking.
I get it.
Noble experiment didn't really work. I won't disagree with that.
I mean, it's like this Will McAvoy is like this truth-telling, amazing, great man he's flawed. But, you know, you must love him because he tells what is, like, he tells the eternal truth.
Will McAvoy is a dick.
That's the thing.
The setup is still that all of these people...
Still look up to him as the idealistic journalistic hero, you know?
I don't know. I feel like that's not how I read it at all.
Yeah. No, that is. He is a dick, but at the same time, he is a good journalist.
Right.
He has good intentions. He's someone who's respected. I think that's the thing. But yeah, so we got to wrap this up, guys.
Yeah, yeah.
So if you want to listen to this entire episode, it's out as a podcast
on Monday.
And it's on iTunes. It's on our own podcasting app, IVM Podcast app.
Yeah, please download the app.
You can please
download
it.
Rate it and, like, you know, say
tell us how much
about
you
it.
Love us, basically.
Yeah.
Love us, please.
Hugs,
all right.
Guys. All right.
Yeah. All right.
Let's go.
Hey man, just help me out, man. I need some podcast, man. I haven't had a fix in a week. Just need some.
Don't you worry about it. I got podcast galore for you, man. Just go to ivmpodcast.com. You can also find us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.
Thanks, man. I'm gonna check it out.